That's a very important thing, because the unsaturated fats are a variety of types, depending upon which carbon atom is unsaturated. If beginning from the last carbon, which is counted as carbon 1, if the third carbon atom is unsaturated, it is called omega 3. If it is the sixth carbon atom is unsaturated, it is called omega 6. And like that, omega 3, omega 6, omega 9, and subsequently it goes on. Most important things are the ratio between omega 3 and omega 6. And that is important because the end products of these fatty acids have vastly different, almost opposite action of each other. For example, omega 6 fats, which are of course present in all the oils that we normally consume, and also present in all cereals and pulses and whatever that a vegetarian normally consumes. Omega 6 fats are broken down into end products which are called cyanides. Omega 6 end products are prothrombotic, pro-aggregatory, and pro-inflammatory. That means inside the blood vessels, they will allow thrombosis of the blood clot to occur very easily. As against that, omega 3 fats, the end products again called cyanoids, they are anti-thrombotic, anti-aggregatory, and anti-inflammatory. Now, a heart attack or a stroke or an occlusion of the blood vessel occurs because when the effect on the blood vessels and the blood circulation is prothrombotic. So if a person were to consume omega 6 in excess, he is bound to get the variety of diseases of the arteries. Now if the ratio is between 1 to 5, or every 1 of omega 3, 5 of omega 6, then the balance is maintained. So that just the right amount of thrombosis will occur if there is a cut and there is a wound and it will not bleed. At the same time, there will not be a clotting factor inside. But when it starts exceeding and goes to 1:25 and more, then the blood vessels will start getting inflamed. And these are the ones where the person may get a lot of problems with ischemic heart disease, strokes, peripheral vascular disease, vision, and practically every organ of the body. So it is mandatory to know that whereas both are necessary, the ratio is very vital. It should not be exceed 1:5. But invariably it exceeds more because very few people take omega 3 fats and most of us consume fried food which is all fried in oils which give us omega 6 fats. And that is what is very vital. Omega 3 fats will be present in very few things. Methi, namori, rajma, akrol, green leafy vegetables and fish. Only 6. No, there is not a 7th article. Fish is out of question because 85% of vegetarian Indians are vegetarians. And therefore they will be consuming only the other ones. And of these, akrol, that is walnut, is consumed very unusually. Only during Diwali time or something. And so it falls back on mostly consuming green leafy vegetables. And not a very popular vegetable, so people would prefer to eat potato and other things rather than eating green leafy vegetables. So that the omega 3 consumption becomes less and less and less. And for everything else, including frying or oil used for just tadka, whatever, they're all omega 6 fats. Not only that, but every cereal, whether it is rice or whether it is wheat or whether it is jawar or bajri, contains a small quantity of oil which is termed as invisible oil. Because whereas oil in a groundnut or other nuts will be visible, you can extract it. We cannot extract oil out of cereal, but every vegetable cell has oil, and that oil is omega 6. So that omega 6 is consumed in a very large quantity in any case, and omega 3 fats are consumed very little.
And where does omega 9 fit into this?
Omega 9 is neutral. And therefore, we will say that if you have three bottles, one made out of ghee, which is omega 9, is ghee contains omega 9. One bottle contains any oil of your choice, that is omega 6. And one bottle of custard oil, which is Mohri's oil, and consume these three bottles more or less in the same way. So at the end of the month, all the three are equally finished, then you are well balanced. There is little risk because the omega 6 is consumed in such a large quantity that we will never ever exceed that ratio. Because our diet is made out of cereals, and the cereals will give us omega 6 fats. However, supposing somebody is a fish eater, let's take it that way, and fish will give you omega 3 fats, and he takes nothing except fish and green leafy vegetables, then his omega 3 consumption will be more. He is a person who is more likely to get bleeding disorder, because there is a person who will not let the blood clot. But such a thing will not happen in India. Omega 6 fats and these cyanoids which are there have injurious effects on number of cells in the body. One of the injurious effects it has is on the beta cells of the pancreas. These cells are responsible for producing insulin. What they do is that these beta cells, a cell is normally mildly elliptical, circular in shape, but when omega 6 fats come in close community, that is converted into a kind of a square shape or a cubical cell. Now the cubical cell is a foreign cell to the body. Body is used to seeing circular and elliptical cells, and therefore it will produce antibodies against them. And as a result of consuming a much higher quantity of omega 6 fats, incidence of diabetes has started rising. What has happened is, because immediately after the Korean War, it was thought that saturated fats are responsible for getting heart disease, and therefore it was wrongly concluded, therefore unsaturated fats might protect heart disease. This was a mistake. So saturated fats like ghee, butter were thrown out of kitchen, and only unsaturated fats were used. These unsaturated fats unfortunately happened to be from omega 6, and the incidence of diabetes started rising. And in Maharashtra particularly, everybody is using safflower and has given up using ghee. Now that is a big mistake, because ghee gave you omega 9 fats which did not cause this harm, whereas all oils including safflower oil give omega 6 fats, and that is harmful. And therefore, if at all one has to consume, Maharashtra does not consume Mohri's tail, and therefore they use either shengdana or tea or any coconut oil for that matter, which is not as bad because it may have a little saturated fat, but they all have omega 6 fats. And therefore, consuming just one type of oil will not be desirable at all. One gram of any fat, whether it is a saturated fat, unsaturated fat, whether it is omega 9 or whatever, will give a person roughly 7 calories. And as against that, 1 gram of protein may give roughly 4.5, and 1 gram of carbohydrate again the same amount. So that if a person were to take any kind of oil in excess, it will keep on adding total calories. And if those calories are not consumed by the right type of exercise a person should do, that will all get converted into body fat and get stored. It will be stored in men mostly in the upper abdomen, and in women mostly in the thighs, breasts, and underneath the skin in different parts. But any extra fat is undesirable. Undoubtedly, fat accumulated in the upper part of the abdomen is associated with greater risk of heart disease, and therefore taking any oil in extra for a man would induce him to get heart disease, whereas in women it may induce a lady to get gallstones and many other things will be associated with increased fat in the body. So it is not desirable to consume any fat in excess. A person should take just enough fat to maintain his calorie balance, which is reflected by the ratio of between his height and his weight.
Right.
If a person were to sort of keep a watch on that you measure the height in kilometers and weight in kilograms, and divide the weight in kilograms by the square of the height, it should not exceed 23, preferably should not exceed, and then between 23 and 27 will be a borderline thing, but ideally it should be between 18 and 23. Then you know he is taking the right quantity of fat or proteins or carbohydrates. If a person were to take most of the need for carbohydrates, is to supply calories, so we get enough calories from our carbohydrates. If we take not enough protein, then our immunity will suffer. Then a person may keep on having lots of problems like coughs and colds and fevers and boils and other things in the body. Proteins are expensive and therefore they are not normally consumed in adequate quantities. And in vegetarian diet it is difficult because proteins in vegetarian diet are difficult to digest. For example, let's take the example of soybean. Soybean is a very rich source of protein, but extremely difficult to digest. So if a person were to consume soybean or add soybean powder to atta or something, he will have problems of indigestion, lot of wind, lot of gas, lot of indigestive material, and that's of no use because that protein will not absorb also. So undoubtedly the best protein a vegetarian can take is milk protein. But 30% of Indians suffer from what is known as lactase insufficiency or deficiency, and therefore too much of milk cannot be digested. You can digest just enough quantity according to what you have been brought up and what you have been used to. But 70% of Indians can digest, and therefore there should be no reason why a person should gradually not increase his quantity of milk or take curds or take buttermilk or any milk product. May not be very practical to measure it every day. Generally we might say that you take as less as omega 6 as possible and allow omega 3 to get settled of its own, and if you are watching your weight, that means the total fat content is adequate. Exercise is mandatory for every person to remain fit. Basically, exercise is of four kinds. First type of exercise is known as static exercise. By the word static we mean there is no or very little movement of the body. So the joints don't move, but muscles act. Like for example during weightlifting or doing dumbbells or springs or Indian dand baitha, where the person is at the same spot. But he can do a lot of exercise that way. These static exercise, they build the muscle mass, they make the person and body beautiful to appear and develop strength and also develop bone density. So it is useful. It is recommended that a person should take between 12 to 15 minutes of static exercise 3 times a week. The second kind of exercise is known as dynamic exercise. By that we mean the joints move, like running, like swimming, like cycling, like brisk walking, or like a game where you might move and the joints might move. And the effect of movement of the joint is rise in the pulse rate, because as the joints keep on moving, blood starts going back to the heart and the heart pumps faster and faster. And science has evolved a formula. 220 is the figure that they have arrived at. 220 minus a person's age, whatever figure you get, make 2/3 of that. That much should be your pulse rate while exercising. If you did that, then you are doing a correct amount and correct speed of your dynamic exercise. This you should do roughly 30 minutes, a minimum of 3 times a week, preferably 5 times a week. 7 times a week is not recommended because it might induce wear and tear of joints and it might cause problems related to the knees and weight-bearing joints. So best is to do that 5 times a week or 6 times a week. That is good enough. And these are the exercises, like as I said, the short runs. One good way of doing that is you have a 10-minute unit of period. You begin by running for 1 minute and walking for 9 minutes. After a few days, once you know that you can do this very easily, you run only for 1 minute but walk now for only 8 minutes. Do not run more than 1 minute at a time, but start cutting short the period of walking. A time will come that you run for 1 minute, walk for 7 minutes, walk for 6 minutes. And eventually you will reach a stage where you will run for 1 minute and walk for 1 minute. And the idea is that whatever breathlessness you have got in that 1 minute, if you are fit enough, then you have got your breath tank in the next 1 minute. And this sort of 10-minute unit can be repeated once or twice or thrice at the most, depending upon your level of fitness and how much you can do. Now this is the kind of dynamic exercise. Dynamic exercises are important to improve the function of the heart as well as of the lungs. So improving the function of the heart and lungs, you do dynamic exercise of this kind. The third kind of exercise is meant to improve the balance, because people who do only static exercise tend to become rigid, and there were many Pehlwans who sort of became so rigid that they could not walk and they had to walk in a different way, and that is what induces hardening of arteries. So you must do, and two well-known exercises. One is all the yogic postures are meant to do to improve our balancing, either in standing position or sitting position or face down position or back down position. The idea is to stretch the joints so that you can keep your balancing better. And this sort of an exercise you should do roughly 15 to 20 minutes 3 times a week. Then lastly, you develop what is known as endurance building exercise. This is the fourth exercise. Endurance building means you are not doing anything which is going to require too much of strength. For that you are going to do static exercises. But you should be able to do a repeated movement for a long time. Let's take the example of a long steady walk. A person should be able to walk 2.5-3 kilometers. That's endurance building, or swimming for a long time. One of the best examples given is when a house is being built and they want to put a slab, then there are people who work for the whole night on a standing slope. All they need to do is take something full of cement and give it up and give the empty thing down. Only move the arms, but do the whole night. And you might do it once, you might do it twice, you might do it 5 times. But do it for the whole night, you need to develop enormous endurance. So also there would be musicians who, when they want to do their practice and they would like to sit at one place for 5 hours, 6 hours, this is not easy. Or a student who is appearing for an exam, he wants to sit and read for a period of 6 hours. All this requires endurance. So for endurance building, you do a slow, repetitive action for a long time. Like go for a slow walk. And by slow walk, you mean your pulse rate cannot rise, like what it did during your dynamic exercises. Slow walk and keep on increasing it. Now if somebody wants to reduce weight, And if you were to walk 40 minutes in the morning and 40 minutes in the evening slowly and on a plain surface, then a person will be using 2000 calories in a week. If a person utilizes 3500 calories, he will be using 1 pound of his body fat. If a person loses 7000 calories, he would lose 1 kilo.